Okay. Thanks for the great introduction, Harish. Does anybody here not know what Scrollback's about? Because I have a slide on that, which I can skip if you guys don't know. Raise your hands if you don't know what Scrollback does. Oh, okay. A lot of people don't know what Scrollback does. So you might have seen a screen like this come up in between talks. You know, out here on the projector, on the screen. So this is a chat room that we build. We are a small startup based out of Bangalore. I think 50% of our team is here right now. We basically provide chat rooms that serve as a meeting place for communities. All right, so Hasgeek is a community, so we provide a chat room for Hasgeek, which they use at all their events. All right, so before I talk about, this talk is basically about the architectural choices that we've made at Scrollback. We didn't go out and make a big top-down decision, read all the literature and then decide, all right, this is what we're going to do. Okay, so we started something and then we gradually evolved into a pattern that we are pretty proud of now. The Scrollback codebase has been evolving for more than a year now, so it's reasonably mature. And one of the cool things, and this is in great contrast to all the other big applications I've worked with in my career, one of the cool things is that as we've evolved, the code base has actually, gone simpler and shrunk and definitely lost a lot of concepts. Usually, when your code base gets older, it adds on craft, right? It adds concepts, it adds new classes and whatnot. But Scrollback has gone in the other direction where we've continuously lost concepts until we have a very, very small core API right now. So this is what Scrollback looks like. Okay, did I make that clear? I hope I did. So Scrollback is a chat room, but it's also a forum and it has chat archives and whatnot. So in a very high level look at what it does, right? It takes messages from all of these places and from the web browser or from all of these places. And it comes into Scrollback, right? Scrollback needs to respond to events from all of these places. And what sorts of events happen? It's a chat room, so people send messages, clearly. But they also come online and go offline. They log in, log out, whatever. A lot of things. So that's a brief overview of what we do. And this talk is really about software architecture, right? So I'm going to take a little bit of time and just ask you guys, what's the first thing that comes to your head when you hear the word software architecture? Anybody? All right. Boring subject from college. I heard something over there. So I was sort of expecting that nobody would give the answer. I was thinking of politics, yes. So I made this slide, just in case. All right. So it's sort of like the default, approach when you come to, software architecture is to build MVC or some variant of MVC. It's basically, I would call it building in layers, building your application in layers. So just to take a step back, why do we do this? Your computer definitely does not care if your application is poorly architected. It will still run. Unless it has got an actual correctness error, it'll just run. So why do you need good architecture? Your good architecture is actually because your brain can't hold your entire program at one shot, right? It's basically your architecting your application is about splitting it up into small chunks so that you can hold all of the moving parts in one chunk in your brain at one time. What variables they have, what functions they have, and its external API and stuff like that. So building things in layers is a great way to do it. So, when I've looked at MVC, right, it's always been very obvious to me what M is. It's clearly your database layers, you make your classes for things. And it's very obvious to me how to scale that also. As your application gets larger and more complex, you'll build more classes. You might build classes and put them in sort of a hierarchy, parent, child, animal, cat, whatever. You've got views, right? Views are what the user sees. And this is also pretty obvious how you scale. As your application gets larger, it gets more screens. If it's Android, you get more activities. If it's a web page, you get more pages or routes or whatever. So it's fairly obvious how you scale that, how you keep that organized. You might have a navigation tree on your view. All right, this controller is sort of, you know, it was never very clear to me what the controller does, honestly. I mean, except for the fact that the controller is what sort of puts these two things together. And there is no sort of well-known common pattern for scaling your controller, how to organize your controller. So, you know, when you have an MVC application and it scales, or you have any application that's built in layers and it scales by expanding the layers. The layers grow horizontally. So your view, which was earlier 5 pages, is now 500 pages. And your model, which might have had a few classes, is now a whole lot more classes. How do you scale the controller? So this is the problem that we faced at Scrollback. You know, when we started off with some sort of a variant of MVC. So I'm going to show you some code samples right now, which I will tell you is this is how the Scrollback code looked a long time ago. But this is not really true. I mean, this is sort of illustrative of what our code was. And the reason I'm not willing to admit that this is what our code was like is because it's very embarrassing. So I'm just going to go on to the code samples. But remember, please don't come to me afterwards and say, hey, how are you so stupid? I mean, this is, no. All right. So, you know, initially, we wrote a controller, which was called whenever a message came in, right? And, you know, we saved the message somewhere, and we wanted to send that message out to IRC. Oh, how many guys here don't know what IRC is? Okay, all right. IRC is a chat network, okay? And it's a really ancient sort of old chat network, but it works well with like large communities. So the open source communities use it. Hasgeek uses it. So that's sort of what it is. But it's a network that is outside of web interfaces and all of that. Okay. So you send the message out into IRC. You send the message out to people who are using your web interface. Okay. So this is you know our initial controller, right? But like I said, I mean, we just don't deal with messages. We deal with a whole bunch more, right? Oh, by the way, I mean, I just realized that, you know, when you get a message from the web, you want to send it to IRC. You know, you want to send it to the IRC channel. But when you get a message from the IRC channel, you don't want to send it back there. You want to send it to all the other guys on the web, but you don't want to send it back to the channel. So the controllers for IRC and for web are kind of slightly different, right? Now, but we are not even just dealing with messages. I mean, we're dealing with a whole bunch more, right? We're dealing with messages. We're dealing with people who are entering and leaving the chat at any point in time. So you end up with like all of these controller functions, all right? In our first iteration of the product, and we built all of that and we launched it, and then this guy, we showed it to a few people, and some guy comes, opens the console, types a message. And our server goes down. We forgot to validate inputs. We forgot to do any sort of authentication. And we didn't, you know, there's a whole bunch of other things that you need to do to build a regular web application, right? So we didn't do logging, for instance. So we needed to now add these things on our existing code base, right? We had 10 or 20 controller functions already written, and we needed to now add validation. Right, so validating a message, validating other things are somewhat similar. There are a lot of things that are common to validating many things. So clearly, you would write a single validate.js and write a function inside that that says validate message. Okay, so you know, are you with me so far? So what you do is like, you know, here's your validate message function that does the actual work of validating, and you've got the call to validate message that you need to add to on web message. But if you remember, there are all of these other functions, and you need to go and insert this, you know, this line that's highlighted in red, validate message. Okay, you need to now go and edit all of these other functions and insert that line. All right, and that's where the, you know, sort of lack of scalability comes in, because you end up having to make a change in many parts of your system when one new feature needs to be added. All right, so that is. Kind of goes against the whole idea that, you know, goes against the goals of architecting your product well. So what we really need is something like that, where I don't go and change it up there in the controller. I write my validator, and then, oh, is that visible? Is the green line visible at the back, folks? All right. Yep. All right, so this is what it does. I know this is not a real JavaScript API, but what I really want is to put all of the code related to validation in one place, and that includes the instruction to tell, you know, dear JavaScript, here's my function validate message. Call this function when, you know, the other thing, the on web message, gets called. All right. Now this is the solution sort of to our controller scalability problem. And so this is, if you look at the on web message function, right, it basically has a list of things to do. Right, it has a list of things to do, and it just needs to do them. So let's see if we can structure it in a different way. I mean, you have the publisher subscriber model. So let's try and do that. I mean, so you've got the on web message event, and that should trigger a bunch of listeners. Okay, so that's the solution that we came up with. So I'm sure that most of you have written event code, right? I mean, you've attached event listeners, you've emitted events to sort of structure your code, whether it's like UI or whatever. So the API, I mean, we gave it the name the bus yesterday. Okay, earlier we just didn't have a name for this. We called it event emitter. Now the bus has a very simple API. I mean, it just does on, which is used to attach an event handler. And you do emit, which emits an event. That's cool. And it's very obvious. So let's just take a quick look at how that solves your problem, right? So earlier, you had like save message, send message IRC or whatnot. You put that all into separate, separate modules, separate files, and your on web message function just emits the event. And then all of these other things just have to listen for that event and then act on it. All right. Now, if you've written evented code, I mean, this 500 over here would sort of stick out. I mean, why do you need that? That's not part of the regular node event emitter or backbone events or whatever. So let's go back to the API. You might see the two highlighted words. I mean, the highlighted arguments over there. See, we started with an event emitter, a regular event emitter, like the node event emitter. And we saw that it wasn't giving us sufficient control. And we needed to make two changes to it to really make our application grow. And so it's no longer a proper event-driven architecture. It's more a event bus architecture. All right, so the two additions that we made to the API are priority and payload. All right. The priority, I'm sure some of you might have guessed already. The priority basically says, here's an event. It has got 10 listeners. And in what order should these listeners be called? Right. So a priority is just a number. So you can imagine an event listeners, all of the listeners being placed on a number line from 0 to 1,000. And while you attach an event listener, you can say, all right, fine, put this listener at number 350 or something of that sort. This is not the most elegant way to solve this problem, I suppose, but it gets the work done, right? And then you've got payload. So every event, you know, if you've written evented code, right? If you've written code on the DOM which responds to a click, right? Your event listener gets an object, an event object, which contains properties of the click. I mean, where the user clicked, was the shift button down, or whatever. So this is similar, but instead of calling it an event object, we're calling it a payload. And the main difference over here is that while listeners are invoked because of the event, the listeners also get the option of actually going back and altering the payload. Okay, your click listener, I mean, you might have five click listeners on a button. All right, all five of them will get exactly the same event object when they're invoked. Right, but the bus architecture that we are building, that's not the case. So there's very strict control over the order in which listeners get invoked, and because of that, we can actually do this. So here's an example, right? Here's a message that came, right, from the web. So when the message came, it just had like type from to and text, okay, and then like a couple of listeners down, the listener might add a couple of properties. I mean, this is how it works, right? I mean, the listeners further downstream need to know the user object, need to have a copy of the user object in order to apply some logic onto this, maybe send a notification or whatever. So there's an upstream listener which loads the user object from the database and attaches it, and then so that the downstream listeners can then use it. So that's user and room. And then we might have another listener which kind of uses a bunch of heuristics to figure out whether this message is likely spam or not. I mean, we have a spam filter, automated one. So does this sound familiar? I mean, do you know about any very popular common library for which this is true? Where you've got a bunch of listeners being invoked sequentially, and then there's a payload that goes through. Express. Express is the right answer, right? I mean, Express, you apply, set up your routes, or you set up your middleware, and then you've got like the body parser which comes and does something, and then you've got like, it modifies the request object and adds the parsed data from the body. So yeah, I mean, Express is one of the, one of the things we referred to while building this architecture. So there's not much code, in this architecture. As you can see, this, it's basically two functions. These functions are really easy. So I went in like, I put it on a GitHub repository yesterday, and it was like really, I had to make a choice between putting it as a gist or making a repository, because it's just 80 lines of code or something like that. All right. So that's, this is the basic framework with which we build our, we have our code organized. And so stepping up a level, we basically build, we organize our code and we organize our files as plugins, all right? So there's a very simple core of the application. It's just an event dispatcher, the bus that you saw. And then all of the functionality of Scrollback is built as plugins, all right? And roughly one plugin corresponds to one feature. The way you as a product person or as a as an engineer on the project would understand the word feature. So for our application, sending messages to the web is a feature. Sending messages to IRC is a different feature. Sending tweets out is a third feature. So each plugin contains some initialization code. It contains a bunch of event listeners that listen on the bus. Okay, these are basically to handle outgoing events. It's basically for the core of Scrollback to say, all right, fine, do this thing in the outside world. Okay, so I'll show you a few examples. And then there are event listeners that listen to external events. So for the for the web thing, right, you might be waiting for people to connect to you. So that's the external event listeners. And sometimes you might need a model and a view and all within your plugin. So what we've done is broken down Scrollback, and instead of having like one huge model layer and a huge view layer, we've said that we've basically broken it vertically into different plugins, and each plugin might have its own model and its own view. So this is a few examples of the plugins we have in the application, right? I mean, so the word plugin invokes this impression that it's some sort of external little thing that enhances the product, but it's not core part of the product. But this is all core parts of the product, and they're all built as plugins. All right, so the way this is now getting into the style that we use. So the way we've done is the entry point into our application is a simple plugin loader. Okay, it creates a bus. So the library is called ebus. It's on npm, I believe. So it creates a bus and it loads up plugins from a bunch of places and instantiates them. I mean, the plugins are just functions like that. All right, the plugins just do module load exports, you call a function bus. It takes a bus and then it attaches. This is an example, right? This is how our IRC plugin works, very roughly. So when it's initialized, it takes a bus. A bus is its sort of communication with the rest of Scrollback. And it creates, it initializes all its IRC connections to the various IRC networks out there. And then on those client objects, it'll attach an event listener for messages. When a message comes in, it emits that message into the bus, right? And that's messages coming inwards. And then you've got the messages going outwards, which is like, you've got a bus. And on the, when a message is going outwards, you just send it out on the client. I mean, this is really stripped down version of what we do in practice. So this is a list of all the sort of server-side events that we handle. I mean, because we have an event listener, and I showed you right in the beginning a slide with all the things that we do. I mean, all the things that users can do on Scrollback. So corresponding to all of them, we've got a bunch of events on the server side. And all of the functionality in Scrollback is basically done by listening to these events. And this is, again, like the same list that I showed you a little while ago. This is the list of plugins on Scrollback on the server side. Now, why do you keep saying server side? It's because we actually use Browserify to bring the same API and the same interface onto the client. All right? So I'm going to... Yeah, so I'm going to quickly go over how this architecture has helped us, you know, organize our client-side code as well. I mean, we earlier had a sort of client-side which was built in Angular, and we ran into a significant number of issues with this. The infinite scroll, it seems, you know, I mean, it looks like a thing that it needs to have, right? You scroll upwards, you load more messages. It is incredibly painful to do. And it wasn't possible in Angular, right? So you've got a client side, and we've got a sort of React-inspired way of building this. But again, the infinite scroll was not possible to do in React, so we just use similar ideas. All of our client-side code is divided into components, and each component is really a plugin. I mean, it uses exactly the same API as a plugin, and we just use Browserify to get it out there. So what you see over there, right? The name and the picture, that's one component. The chat scrolling area is one component. The send box is one component. Each of the tabs over here on the left side are one component. So you've got like basically a whole bunch of components, and they do not talk to each other except by emitting and listening to events. Right. So Scrollback is completely open source. And I mean, everything we do is open source. All right? All the code we write is open source. And it's all on GitHub. The Scrollback application itself is up there. The library that we wrote for doing this event-driven architecture is up on GitHub. And that's me. That's it. Thank you. Any questions?
Hi. When you were talking about the client-side architecture using Browserify and using components, so each of these components has a view and controller of its own? Or how
absolutely, absolutely. It, now, these are small enough that it's really not necessary. For instance, the little thing on the right, top right, you know, this one is just one file or so. So it doesn't really need a lot of division, but some of the larger client-side components are divided into a view and a controller of its own. Yes, so the controller part. So we just want to separate out the DOM manipulation from the part that communicates through the bus API.
So you write inline HTML with the JavaScript, or do you load them?
No. Okay, so how Browserify works is you write it like you write Node code, okay? So we've got one entry point for running the Node application, right? I mean, to run the server, you type node server.js. Okay, and that runs the server. And you've got another file over there, which does client.js, and which looks exactly like this, all right? I might have shown you this plugin loader. All right, this is sort of how our server.js looks. Okay, it requires one plugin after another and calls initialize on them. Okay. Our client-side code is written exactly the same way. So there are some plugins, and if you look at our code base, we haven't even really divided them up into like here are the client-side plugins and here are the server-side plugins. They're all mixed up together. That's because some plugins, surprisingly, have both client-side and server-side components. So for instance, I can sign in using Facebook. Okay. So there's a little Facebook sign-in button that comes on the client side. There's a lot of client-side code which calls the Facebook APIs and whatnot. Okay, but then there's also server-side code for that, which, you know, communicates with the Facebook servers. And we didn't want to put these as two separate things, which we had to update separately. We made it into a single app. So coming back to your point about Browserify, okay? So you've got Hi. All right. So before this went all blank on me, you might have like seen the server-side code. For Browserify, you write exactly the same file, call it client.js, and you do Browserify client.js. It goes out and fetches all of them, all of its require statements. It goes through require statements, takes all the required dependencies, packs it up into one file, call it bundle.js. And on your client side, right, we've got a client HTML which includes the bundle.js as one shot. So all of our code is kind of minified and put inside bundle.js. Okay, so we do not use inline JavaScript. What we do have right now is sort of inline, I wouldn't call it inline, we use partials. Okay, so each of these, each piece of the scrollback user interface, right? So each piece of the scrollback interface, you know, it has some DOM elements, you know, to make itself visible. So those DOM elements are defined in a separate static HTML file, sort of. But we've internally maintained this idea that this bunch of DOM elements are all, you know, owned by a certain component. So you have these DOM elements, which are only touched by one component at a time. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. I had a question.
Okay.
It's the same.
So could you raise your hand? All right.
This side.
Oh, all right. Sorry, man. Okay.
Sorry, I'm in the last. I had two questions. So as I can see, there'll be a lot of eventing because you have eventing on messages, you have eventing on failovers, on login and logout. So I just want to know, I have two aspects that I'm looking at. The first is, how about performance? Because there's a lot of eventing happening on the bus. And the second is, how about failover? So let's say event happened, but it doesn't reach the bus due to some reason. So how do you handle these two scenarios?
All right. So failover is not handled right now. Okay. So I mean, I'm not entirely sure. So we are not running each plugin as a different process, right? I mean, they're all running as part of the same process, the same node process. So the normal and the event, you know, calling event listeners, for instance, is basically function calls. I mean, it's function calls wrapped in a process.next tick so that the stack doesn't grow too large, but it's basically simple function calls. So all of the stability issues, I mean, that you've said are basically general stability issues with Node.js. Your question was, could you repeat the first part of your question?
So from failover, from the perspective that let's say we have a stack and there are a lot of messages which come in, so that's going to affect the performance because now there are so many listeners to a particular event, and then you have to go ahead and iterate over those particular, internally it's going to iterate over those and find the correct listener, that is one. So performance is going to be affected. And the second part of it is the stack goes huge, then at some point of time, you know, probably you might have like an Explorer crashing, or at some point of time an event is missed because whatever payload you're sending might have some kind of a negative character, so those kind of scenarios. So how do you handle events which have been missed?
Okay. So coming to your first point about performance, right? I mean, basically, all of the plugins are asynchronous, okay? So all of the plugins are written asynchronously. So in that, you get one plugin gets invoked, and like just because it's running or it's waiting on the event loop for like, you know, some IO to happen, doesn't mean that another event is not processed, okay? They're asynchronous, so the order in which event handlers get fired for different events, you know, when multiple events are being fired, they will all get processed together in parallel, sort of. So I'll give you performance numbers, I guess. I think we have easily seen more than 1,000 simultaneous connections in, you know, including WebSockets and IRC in one instance. All right. So I'm not very sure what we haven't done load testing to sort of destructive load testing to figure out to what, you know, at what point it will fail. That's because our code is iterating too fast, and we're not very sure if we do a test right now and we get some results, it's not going to be valid for much longer. The second question about failure, I don't really think that is likely. I mean, certainly it will slow down. When the server's under heavy load, it's going to slow down. Okay. But ultimately, these events are being fed from I/O. Either it's a network connection through WebSockets, or it's, you know, So it's basically node streams, right?
Right.
So when the server's under load, it'll stop, you know, reading from those streams.
Right.
Okay. So it'll stop reading from those streams. Those streams will buffer, and maybe under extremely heavy load, those buffers will fill up and the server would crash. But we haven't really seen that yet.
All right. So we evaluated the same thing. That's the reason I asked it. We have very similar product, and then we went with the concept of channels. So we have multiple channels which we have used Postal, by the way. And we have multiple channels, and then every event is broadcast on the same kind of channel. So that makes performance better theoretically, but then I didn't find any data or numbers, as you said.
Okay, I would love to talk to you outside.
Sure. Thank you.
Sure. Okay, so that's a lot of questions.
Wow,
this is a really tough question. Okay, so the reason this is tough is not because it's hard to explain, but it's really painful that nobody gets it. Because it's one of my favorite parts of the UI, but nobody gets it. So that kind of tells you that I'm terrible at designing UI. So the dots mean that we have this scrollback product feature, right? We try to figure out from this flat chat log what topics are being discussed, and we try to separate each discussion out into a separate what we call a conversation, right? So you over here the conversation titles, and all of these things are being automatically generated using NLP. Okay, so when every message comes in, there's a classifier which tries to figure out this message belongs to which conversation and whatnot, and then we put them into sort of these conversations so that for SEO, for instance, it's great. So you guys have been talking about lunch at JS4, so 5 days later, if somebody wants to Google, hey, how's the lunch at JS Foo? Maybe this would come up in the Google search results. All right. So if it were a simple flat chat log, then it's Google doesn't like that. So does that make sense? Did I answer it in a way that was comprehensible? Okay. So the dots basically indicate that these are part of the same conversation. So the algorithm thinks that the messages by Rykov and Iliact are part of one conversation while the others are not. So the dots and the lines basically say these are part of the same conversation. And then you can maybe click on one of these messages, and then you can reply. And Rykov, you can just hit at the top right, you got your name over there. I mean, just click on that and sign in using Facebook or Mozilla persona. Sorry about that. Yes.
Right, so I'd like to know what issues you faced on a very high level. I mean,
the biggest issue was getting the infinite scroll work. The infinite scroll is not possible without very fine-grained control over DOM elements. You need to directly manipulate DOM elements, set the scroll top, and that sort of thing, without which you can do it. So we tried to do it by writing a directive. And then we saw that we weren't really following angular patterns at all. I mean, we were just directly manipulating the DOM all over the place. So there are various things that happen which need us to touch the infinite scrolling thing. So it's basically problems around infinite scroll.
Thanks.
We'll take this one and then we'll move on to the next one. Hi. Scrollback is cool. I like it.
Thank you.
So you were showing that diagram of messages and your plugins mutating and them becoming different messages. So there's this framework called RxJS. Have you heard of it?
Yes, I've just heard the name. I haven't really had a chance to look at it.
So I guess what you can do with that is treat your stream itself as a value and then apply transformations on the stream. So I guess your plugins
is quite similar to what I think we'll definitely take a look at that. Right.
Okay. So your plugins will basically become a function.
Right. Okay. All right.
Okay. Yeah.